having of both speakers. We'll get them both back up here and they'll be open for you to ask all the questions you want. So our next speaker is Professor Doreen Cantrell from the University of Dundee in the UK, and she's very kindly offered to give this extra talk as an invited speaker here at ASLA and tell us a little bit about her personal experiences of trying to, she's been very successful but also managed to remain sane while having a successful career and balancing her work and life. So thank you.
Sure, how to get my slide up. Oh, there it is. Sanity and success. I mean, a lot of what Anne said resonates with me. Actually, Anne, it seems just like yesterday we met. Sanity and success. Well, this is one of my sanity things. Walking in the hills of Scotland keeps me sane. Some people would say not necessarily, but it does. I think the first thing I want to say about, you know, what I've learned about life is that the scientific challenges that we have are the same. Men and women, there's no difference there. And you know, you've got the key thing you've got to do before you worry about anything else. You've got to find your research question, you've got to persuade someone to fund you, and then you've got to actually deliver. And if you don't do that, it doesn't matter whether you're a man or a woman, you won't succeed. And that really is, we forget this sometimes. Nobody can do this for you. This is the bit you've got to take responsibility for to do yourself. And it is tough, it really is tough, I think, to do that. But what I wanted to do was not really talk about sort of specific issues about gender in the UK. Actually, the data I presented for funding in Australia would pretty much be the data we would have if we presented it, the funding in the UK. I'm just going to allude quickly to the Athena Swan program. One of the things about the Athena Swan program is it does mean that your universities have to collect data about gender equality. One of the things that shocked me when we got that gender data was not how bad it was in life sciences, which was pretty much the way I said, but how it was phenomenally worse in the arts subjects. I had really thought, you know, because they don't have to work in a lab 14 hours a day. They can work flexibly, they can work at home. But it was worse, you know, really terrible. Really, really terrible. So this is not just a problem, this gender equality issue, it's not just a problem for science. And actually, I think science does a lot better than a lot of other areas in life that I'll talk to people about later. Now, I'm going to talk to you about, you know, my attempt to carve a career and maintain sanity and be successful. A lot of people who know me closely would debate about the maintaining sanity side of it. But I need to tell you about myself. I'm a Wellcome Trust Principal Research Fellow, which means my salary and my research group are funded by the Wellcome Trust, which is a really great organization. I'm also Dean of the School of Life Sciences in the University of Dundee. This is a big life sciences department in the UK. We have about 1,000 scientists working in that department, so that's quite a big responsibility. I thought I'd put on here some of the other jobs I do and have done over the years. I started off doing grant reviewing at quite a young age, you know, really in my late 30s, early 40s, I joined a grant review panels. And since then, I've taken on those roles, and I have a bit of a reputation for not saying no when I'm asked to do these things. And you can see they take me all over the place. For example, when I was chair of the Wellcome Trust DBT India Alliance Scholarship Panel, that meant I had to spend quite a bit of time in India working for the Wellcome Trust. I also spent a lot of time at the Medical Research Council, where I chaired the Immunology and Infection Panel for 4 years, and that really meant I was seconded to the Medical Research Council for 40% of my time to do that, so that was a big ask. And I'm currently a member of MRC Council, and I'm also, you know, still do work for the Wellcome Trust. So I do lots of different things, and I think that's been quite important to take on those roles, because it really is critical that women have a voice. And the only way to have a voice is actually to be at the table. And so I just always made sure I was at the table, because otherwise people wouldn't listen to me. And I would say as well that I was, you know, I was a pretty shy graduate student. People can't quite believe that of me now, but at the time I was. This is another job I do. I'm a mother. These are my daughters. I've put the years that they were born, and I'll talk to you a little bit about which stages of my career they were born. That's obviously been a pretty big job, a very, very enjoyable part of my life. But what I wanted to talk, because I think this is what's important to young people, is thinking about decisions that you have to make. And I want to talk to you about some of the things that shaped my decisions. You know, I had a pretty normal upbringing in England. I went to school. I come from Dover in Kent, which is a very tiny town in the southeast of the country. And one big decision I made when I was 18 was this decision. 1975, I made the decision to take a gap year, that is, not go straight to university, take a year out, and go and work abroad. And I somehow, and it's a complicated story, I ended up working in Chiang Mai, which at that time was a tiny town in northern Thailand. There was a war going on in Laos, the Khmer Republic. It was the Khmer Republic in those days. It's Cambodia now. The Vietnam War had just finished. It was quite an interesting place to be. And actually, one of the things that happened when I was there, there were probably only about 300 non-Thai people living in the town at the time. British diplomats, American drug enforcement agencies, American diplomats, and there were some wives there of people, men who'd gone out there to work. And they set up a feminist consciousness raising group. This was the 70s, and I went along to that group because, you know, it was a whole load of women. And there were 10 women, most of them were over 40 years old. They had families. They were all college-educated women. Most of them were American, and they'd been to the top colleges in America. They'd been to Stanford, they'd been to Harvard. They'd all got married and decided to follow their husband's careers. They'd never worked. They were terribly frustrated at this point in their lives with being wives and mothers. And that was a big lesson to me. The big lesson was that, you know, if you decide, and it's a bit harsh, if you decide to let someone else decide where you're going to be in life, there will be consequences of that, and there may not be consequences that you like. Now, there were two women in that group who were very impressive. I felt they were all an impressive group of women. One was a university lecturer who had, at the University of Chiang Mai, who had a PhD, and she was Scottish, and she had a PhD in chemistry from Edinburgh University. I'd never met anybody with a PhD before, because I didn't come from a sort of town where anybody had PhDs. So there was my first role model. Wow, what an exciting life. But at that point, that was when I thought, okay, plan A, go to university, get a PhD, not chemistry, because I knew that was hopeless, and then go back to Thailand, and I'd spend this lovely, exciting life doing this. There was also the American vice consul in Chiang Mai at that time was also a woman, a very, very impressive woman. So I actually saw, I got these role models of women who were making their own decisions and women who effectively had given up their decisions and allowed marriage to dictate what their role in life was going to be. It may seem impossible to you in those days that's what women did, but in the 70s they really, really did. It was really quite interesting to see that. So I decided I wanted to be the person in charge of my own destiny. And I didn't realize, it's only looking back now I realize how profound an influence on me that actually was. And I think that's really influenced the way I've gone. I went off to University College of Wales, Aberystwyth, to do a Bachelor of Science degree in Zoology. That's the seafront in Aberystwyth last year in a storm. I arrived to study ecology but switched to zoology. There's a number of key points on there. First of all, I failed first year biochemistry because I really didn't ever work at it. I got married in term two, year two, which was a slightly surprising thing to do to me and everybody who knew me. But I had some very inspiring teachers, particularly there was a woman, Gwendolyn Rees, fellow of the Royal Society of Parasitologists. She was about 70 years old, and she demonstrated to us. I mean, that was really, she was amazing. And again, I saw this really, really strong female role model. There were pretty amazing male mentors as well, particularly Philip Waring and Mike Hall, who were plant physiologists, who were really very, very encouraging and encouraged on my interest in molecular stuff. I actually pretty much bumped around the bottom of the class for year one and year two, and then when I got to the end of the year, I got first class honors and became top of the class. Yeah. I'm only saying that to you because what happened to cause that change? These mentors, particularly Mike Hall, told me I had to work harder. Nobody had ever told me that before, you know, so I've never really bothered to study. I just thought you didn't have to study, you just sort of missed Monday morning lectures, that was a given. and you missed Friday afternoon practical classes because the weekend was for mountain walking and stuff. So, you know, the third year I finally took some advice from somebody, and I think that's important. Listen to what people say to you and do take their advice, because it really can work. Now, after university, my first decision was job or PhD, but I had a main objective, and this is an objective that many of you will share. My husband is 5 years older than me, and he was already earning a lot of money, so we decided to that we would co-locate to where he was going to be, because he had a job, and I just went to find a job or PhD in the vicinity of where he was. And one option was to do a PhD in immunology at Nottingham University, and that's what I decided to do. I looked at a couple of other jobs, but actually with option one and option two, I did apply for the jobs, but they rejected me. I didn't think they were probably right about that. So I did the PhD in Nottingham. Now, my supervisor, Nottingham University is not renowned for its immunology. It was a very small department. It was very well funded. It was funded by Cancer Research UK, so we had lots of money. We had a flow cytometer, which was, we had a fact cell sorter. It was only the second cell sorter to be in the UK, so actually we did have good resources. But one of the things I also had at that time was I had two mentors, Alan Williams and Don Mason, who were in Oxford University. Now, how did I get those mentors? Because I was in Nottingham, I'd been to Aberystwyth University, and I'd never even been to Oxford. Alan was Australian, actually. Not the most politically correct person in the world. Anybody who ever knew him would know that. But I basically contacted them and said I needed some help. I literally, in those days, you had to write a letter. So I just actually wrote a letter and said, I really want to know about some of the work you're doing. Can I come and visit you? And they immediately both responded in a very, very positive way. And I think that was a lesson to me as well. Don't wait to be asked. You've got to take responsibility and you've got to drive your contacts. And nobody is ever offended if you write to them and say, I think your science is fantastic, can I come and talk to you? Usually people are quite flattered, and usually they will talk to you and take the time if you reach out to them. So don't be afraid to reach out. That's been I've reached out many times in my life, and that's actually been extremely helpful to me and allowed me to get contacts. And with emails these days, it's even easier than it was with writing a letter. I had to go to the post office and buy a stamp in those days, whereas you could just get on a computer and write. After my PhD, I decided to do a postdoctoral fellowship in America with Kendall Smith, working at Dartmouth Medical School in Hanover, New Hampshire. Now, that was a bit of a problem, because the postdoctoral fellowship was in America, and my husband's job was in the UK, and he couldn't relocate. So the decision was, do I go or do I stay? And that was where I made the decision to go. And my husband stayed in the UK. Our families thought we were crazy, you know, and there was a lot of pressure on us from family, particularly, actually a lot of pressure on my husband, really. Why was he allowing his wife to go to America? But we decided this would work. If you have a strong relationship, you can survive being away. And I went to the States and I took the risk. I only stayed for 2 years, that's the compromise. You know, because I wanted to stay for longer. I was having a great time, very successful postdoc. Those are some of the papers we got. And I would have liked to stay later, but that's the compromise. You know, I did enough and I came to succeed and prove to me that science is what I wanted to do. And then I came back to the UK and I took up a second postdoc in Mike Crumpton's lab at the Imperial Cancer Research Fund in London, which is now known as the London Research Institute of Cancer Research UK. Actually, that's not true. It's now known as the Crick Institute. It's changed its name again. And I chose that institute because it was the best institute in the United Kingdom to work in. It was the best funded institute, and I felt I needed to work there. And I just wrote to Mike from the States and said, can I come and work in your lab? And he said, yeah, that's fine, you know, come. Again, you know, I didn't wait for a job to appear. I just proactively wrote and got the job, and I think I was offered a fellowship to go there, and that was really, again, quite important, and I think, again, it influences that you have to try and carve your own career, have clear ideas of what you want to do. It won't always work out, but there's a chance it will. So that was why I went there. Now, and as I say, this is it really. The key thing about this was that I knew what I wanted to do, and I decided to find the best place in the world to do it. But there was also the compromise. At that time, I was offered jobs. I was offered a postdoctoral fellowship at the University of Washington University in St. Louis, also in Seattle, and also at Karolinska, because I'd had quite a successful postdoc. But I thought, no, London. Now, I'm actually a small town person. I hate big cities. And I hated every minute I worked in London, I should say. I loved the Institute, but London was just horrific for me. But that's the compromise. I needed to be somewhere that was really, really good and that I could be close to my husband. Has being a woman been a problem, and did I encounter more problems than my male colleagues over the course of my career? I actually don't think I did, but obviously this is one issue that comes up. You know, children, when do you have them? When's the best time to have children? There's no answer, no easy answer to that. I can just tell you when I had my children. I had my first daughter in 1985 when I was a postdoctoral fellow in London. And then I had my second two children between 1987 and 1992 when I was a tenure track principal investigator at the Imperial Cancer Research Fund. So some people say, no stable job, no security, is that the right time to have kids? Well, you know, I don't think there is a good time. I've certainly found out that when I became tenured, my job got harder and harder and harder. It certainly didn't actually get easier. So, you know, I think you can make it work at whatever time you choose to have kids. You really can. And I'll just point out some of the problems we had in those days. I didn't perceive them as problems. I didn't think I had the right to anything. And what the one issue was in 1985 in ICRF, there was no maternity leave for postdocs at all. I was quite lucky because Mike Crumpton arranged for me to have 6 weeks unpaid leave while I had my daughter. And I worked right up until the very end of the pregnancy, and then I went off and had a baby. By 1988, things had changed. When I had my second child, we had 8 weeks fully paid maternity leave, and by 1991, when I had my third child, we had 14 weeks. So I was at a time when you were seeing great, great progression in that process. So I didn't take a long period of maternity leave. But one of the things that sounds like things were really bad at ICRF, but for women, actually they were fantastic. Because when I told Mike Crumpton I was pregnant, this was in 1985, the first thing he said was, well, actually, I went to the first thing he said was, he was a bit surprised, because he'd never had a female postdoc pregnant before. His second response, though, was to say, well, what can we do to make this work? What do you need? And it was lucky we were in a well-founded industry. This is something I think we need to do, is he gave me a technician to work with me. His technician was a wonderful woman called Addie Davis. Mike said to me, okay, I'll stop Addie working on my project. She can work with you. And then you can do your projects, you can carry on doing your science while you're off having the baby. And that was really, really fantastic. And that was why I was able to be successful, because I got support from the Institute in terms of having somebody to work with me. And we were pretty successful as a team, Addie and I. We went through a period when either I was pregnant or Addie was pregnant. And so we had lots of kids, but we were a great team. Over that time, I had 37 publications. And that was because I was working as a team, and I think that was quite important. And it comes back to one of the decisions I had to make, and I want to talk about how I coped with having children and that. And a key thing about science is it's very flexible. So one reason I think I was able to cope with having children was because of the flexible working patterns that you can have as a scientist. You do not need to work from 9 to 5. You can be very, very flexible. And so I worked out a kind of point where I'm not a morning person, so I would go into work later in the day, and come home later, because that suited my sort of schedule. And I was able to do that because I had a partner who truly, truly shared childcare responsibilities. I mean, people say to me, Dorian, you were the trailblazer. Actually, my husband was the trailblazer, because my husband was working in a very macho industry. He was in the brewing industry. My husband actually was the person who introduced Castle Beer, Castlemaine 4X, is it, the Australian beer, into the UK. That was one of his projects. And trust me, the brewing industry is the most chauvinistic industry you can imagine. So he had to put up with lots of comments about being under my thumb, about was he, you know, who was in charge, but he really did take full responsibility, and I think that's very important. One of the things I do sometimes see with young women who have children is they actually are scared to give up some of their child caring responsibilities to their partner. And that's because the partner will never take care of your baby the way you will take care of your baby. I always remember the first time, one of the times I was away, when I came back from a meeting and my husband and my daughter met me at London Airport, and she was wearing pink trousers and a red anorak. He should have known that that was not the combination to go. And her mouth was smeared with chocolate, which was also something that was clearly not allowed. And I should say, her first solid food was a ginger biscuit that he had dipped into tea. But, you know, she survived. And I just had to learn to keep quiet, you know. My parenting was perfect, his was not, but, you know, he would get like, I'm joking, he was pretty good. He was pretty good. And that's really quite important. Now, there were compromises. And one of the compromises I made was to be in this institute in central London. And that's no place to bring up a family. So my compromise was that we lived outside the city. We actually lived in Cambridge, and I commuted into the city for 20 years. That was a 3 to 4 hour commute every day, which was a pretty big compromise, but it allowed me to do what I wanted to do. And I was able to be in this institute where we have a lot of core funding, so I didn't have to write grants. I was just judged retrospectively, while maintaining a pretty good family life so that my children could grow up in what I thought was a better environment than being in Cambridge as compared to central London. And again, this was only possible because my husband was prepared to share childcare responsibility. And I think one of the things that still shocks me today is this fact that men and women do not equally share childcare. The fact that the burden still falls on women. I see it all the time. And that's something that we have to change if we're really going to have progress, and if you're really going to be able to see equal progression for men and women, I think, in any area. Now, maintaining sanity, I think I was very realistic about what I could do. I tried to be realistic, and I didn't expect things to be perfect at home. I had to put up with the criticism. Who's reading the daughters the bedtime stories? I have to say, I have never read my children a bedtime story. That was my husband's job. My job, you know, I did other things. I made an early decision to give up bench work myself and to focus on guiding experiments of others, my students, and thinking strategically rather than doing the experiments myself. Now that's actually quite a scary thing to do, but I think if you're trying to balance everything, you know, I gave up actually after I'd stuck, you know, it got to the point where I left the cells in the centrifuge. I'd be halfway home and I'd realize the cells would still be in the centrifuge and I had to call up and get someone else to finish the experiment. And I decided, no. I was better off thinking about what we had to do and being strategic. And so I gave up pretty quickly. And that was, again, a compromise because I did enjoy doing experiments. But you really you can't do everything. And if you got to, but so choose what you can do that's best, I think. And that, for me, was the decision. Now, how to combine family life with this thing that Anne talked about, that you've got to have your networks. And it's obviously very difficult to travel and move institutes and so forth. One of the ways I coped was by doing the commuting, not moaning about it. I used to talk about the commuting time as me time, which it was actually. I could sit there, think about things. But you have, in science, you've got to be able to maintain your networks. So one of the things I did was I included my children in my work life. I regularly took them to meetings all over the world. My youngest daughter's first trip, I just give you this one example, was in 1991 when she was 10 weeks old and she came with me to Japan where I was giving a plenary talk at a meeting, and I had had the invitation before I'd been pregnant, and I got pregnant and had the baby, and I thought, yeah, I'll still go. She survived. It was a slightly traumatic plane journey, 18-hour plane journey with a 10-week-old baby, but we survived, and I think actually I never found I was unwelcome at meetings with my children. People would always help me. At that particular meeting in Japan, the organizers, when I asked them if they could help me find childcare, they not only helped me find childcare, they actually paid for the childcare for me, which was, again, very, very enlightened at the time. But I think it was because when you asked people for support, I found they tended to want to give it. And maybe we don't ask enough, I don't know. Another example of something I did, in 1992, I had just got tenure and I decided I needed to experience another institute, and so I decided to do a mini sabbatical at the WEHI in Melbourne. And I came here for 4 months. It was over the British summer, the Melbourne winter, so I know what Melbourne in August is like. And I came with my 3 daughters. And again, you know, it sounds like it's impossible, but why is it impossible? It worked quite well. We came over here, we had a great time. My eldest 2 daughters went into North Melbourne Primary. You know, I had a nanny at that point who I brought with me. And it was a sort of, again, coming back to compromises, one thing you do find if you're a scientist and you have children is that you will never, ever have any money because you will be spending all your money on childcare. And that's kind of the way it went. And so I just used to, you know, devote all my salary pretty much to taking care of the children and making sure we could sort of balance everything. But again, in terms of coming here, the Royal Society of London funded me to come here, and they funded the cost of my fare here and my living accommodation here. But they also paid for my children's fares to come, and they paid for the living costs and for my nanny to come. So that was in 1992. So these things were not there as policies, but they were there, and there was support there if you went out and asked for it. And so I was able, through this type of mechanism, to maintain a profile, maintain my contacts throughout the world, and get my career. So I think what I want to say to people here is that, you know, I think science is a very difficult career because you've really got to do all this stuff of finding the research question. But the rest of it, there's ways around it if you're prepared to be flexible. And you do have to quite frequently ignore the comments of others. I had to frequently ignore the comments of mothers at the school door about whether my children really knew who their mother was. Did they think the nanny was the mother and stuff like this? You know, we just have to let that go, you know, and do what you think is right for you and your family. And interestingly, if I talk to my children today, they don't remember me being away at work. You know, they don't really remember it at all. You know, it was just normal life to them. I was there when they needed me. And science is so flexible that if they were sick, I could take time off. There's many jobs where you can't do that, but actually if you're a research scientist, you really can be pretty flexible. So I think you've got to be pretty determined. You've got to be very tough, I think, and quite physically, have a lot of physical stamina to be a scientist, as we all know, because it does require a lot of long hours. And I think if you want to combine family life with having children, that physical stamina becomes even more important, because you have to be able to cope without a lack of sleep. But it is possible to do both. I think, and I think I'll just finish on that point, that flexibility and asking for support from your institute and from the organizations around you, you will find it there. If it was there in the 90s for me, it will be there for you today if you ask.